LACMA.
Oh, no, I don't want to hear about this. Daniel, what's LACMA?
LACMA is the story of Los Angeles.
Sleepy Pueblo town.
Fade in on a painting of a sleepy Pueblo town. You're in LACMA, baby. The story of the Los Angeles County Museum of Art is long and complicated and vast, and in a lot of parts, not very interesting. But I found that the most interesting and cohesive way to tell its story is an example of how a public art museum grows and expands, and how the director of a museum and its donors and curators can change the museum's direction and sculpt what was just an art collection into a world-class museum.
That sounds terrifying.
Well, you're gonna have to learn how to do this, because I can't run this museum forever.
Oh no. Is that why you brought me into this factory? Is that why you gave me the golden ticket? Because now I have to do work?
Run home, Charlie. You lose.
Good day, sir.
LACMA is an encyclopedic art museum. So it
doesn't... What does that even mean?
It means that it doesn't just focus on one thing. So some areas of it are stronger than others, but the story is how these certain areas became strong and how certain areas aren't given the nurturing they need and turn into the Greg and Daniels of the art world.
High five on that.
Oh, I would, but our bones are way too weak and unnurtured.
I'm just so brittle.
Let's do it anyway.
It's rain and bone. Hallelujah.
Ooh, my throat. It all began dismally on November 6, 1913, in Exposition Park, with the opening of the Los Angeles Museum of History, Science, and Art.
Three boring things. No, that sounds really neat, actually.
Well, listen, well, you know, shut up. So, for once in your life, just, you know, I'm talking. The museum had no art of its own, so it had a collection loaned to it for the opening, I believe, from the Fine Arts League. Uh-huh. After the opening, the art was given back, and there was no art in the museum. They didn't even have money to get any art either.
Oh.
But they did have an art curator.
Start painting quick.
His name was Everett Maxwell, and before long they bought their first painting, Cliff Dwellers, by George Bellows, and by 1916 they had expanded their art collection all the way to a jaw-dropping 8 paintings. Oh. But then the boom actually did happen, and a few years after that the collection expanded to several hundred works.
That's more than 8.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true. That's true. I had to dust off my old TI-89.
Well, that because had to come out of the drawer.
The expansion happened because during the 20s and 30s, donors began contributing their personal collections, and then community support was coming in. They got so much new art coming in, they added a new wing to the museum to accommodate all of it. They needed room for racks. Nice racks.
Oh, good racks you got here.
I like what you...
What is this, 9x2?
Since the art section of the museum didn't have much funding, to keep up with all the chaos, they relied again heavily on volunteers and assistant curators, almost all of whom were women. And this is because art is for women, as we all know.
Girls just want to get funding.
Boys don't curate. It was because back in those days, most women didn't have full-time jobs and wanted to do things they were interested in, but wouldn't get hired by most places, just like with the library system. Yeah. They were allowed into the nonprofit world of art museuming. There was Helen B. Wood in 1919, who pushed for more local artists to be put on display. There was Mary E. Marsh in 1922, who was actually made curator, which technically makes her the first female curator for the LACMA collection.
Yay.
But she left the job just 3 months in because she got married.
Oh, I hope to someone who was progressive too.
Yeah, progressive, like progress yourself into my house and never leave. There was Mildred McLuth, who was assistant curator until 1927, and then Louise Upton after her until 1940.
Loving all these names.
Very early 1900s.
It varies.
A local woman named, oh, here's one for you, Ebria Feinblatt. She got hired.
I love her.
She got hired in 1947 and got a huge collection of prints and drawings going. Much later in the 60s, which we're jumping ahead a little bit, it was a group of women who started LACMA's docent program, which is very well renowned and to this day is still mostly women.
Cool.
Camilla Chandler Frost, who is the daughter of Dorothy Chandler.
Oh, really?
Joined the LACMA board in 1962, and in addition to leading docent tours, she gave a total of 2,480 works to the museum, valued at $20 million, and then also $60,000 to start a program to bus kids in from the poorer parts of town so that they would have a chance to come see the museum.
That's like the most amazing thing I've ever heard.
Yeah, but she wasn't a man, so they cut the funding.
Yeah, but she didn't drive the bus herself, so, you know, they didn't give her credit.
Instead of buses, can it be like hot rods and they just pick up like really hot chicks? And instead of the museum, they sent him to a strip club where they now have to work forever.
And the strip club is also on fire.
This lady who we just mocked is still alive if you want to send her a thank you card or ask her for some money.
We're going to do both.
Thank you. Money. There was Anna Bing Arnold, who had been a donor for years but officially joined the board in 1965. She was called LACMA's angel because whenever they needed something but couldn't find anybody who would buy it for them, she would. She died in 2003, but when she did, she left an endowment for off-site arts education. It was the largest endowment LACMA ever got, and they won't tell how much it was. But to give you a hint, they spend $1 million every year on arts programs for kindergarten through eighth grade public schools. So take a guess.
Yeah.
I'm going to say $1 million.
Trillion.
But back in the 20s and 30s, step back a little bit, the collection may have been getting bigger, but it wasn't very good. So most of what they were displaying were loans or traveling exhibitions from better museums, which were mostly organized, again, by the women volunteers. But I think women get enough credit in the world, so let's go back to the men. Especially in history. I mean, come on. Do we need another female president?
Cut to men peeing in the Pacific Ocean.
Because they think it's funny. Because they can do it standing up. Some early major donors... What?
My bottoms aren't getting wet.
Some early major donors were J. Paul Getty and William Preston Harrison, but in the mid-40s, a huge contribution of art came from William Randolph Hearst. Ooh. In the form of European, American, and Egyptian pieces. Then in the late 40s, they finally hired an art director with an actual art background in the form of James Henry Breasted Jr. James Henry Breasted Jr., Breasted. The man whose name is also technically a sentence. And they actually started to get a good collection going. With something of a legitimate reputation now, they started to get the crazy notion that maybe the art should get its own museum since it was bursting out of Exposition Park. And by 1956, Richard Fargo Brown was pushing for just that. The county eventually agreed, and in 1961, they were granted 7 acres of land on the La Brea Tar Pits.
Woo! The oldest spot in the city.
They were next to them, really. In November...
That was an art installation. Is that not an art installation?
Yeah. The Woolly Mammoth. It's a metaphor for...
I get it. Yeah. For elephants.
It's a stand-in for the modern elephant. An elephant that doesn't take no guff from nobody. In November 1962, the groundbreaking began on the new $11.5 million museum, and in 1963, the art officially split from the Los Angeles Museum of History, Science, and Art, and they were now known by their new and current name, the Natural History Museum of Los Angeles.
Oh, cool.
Save the big reveal for the end.
I like that.
By 1965, the art had all been moved out of its parents' house into its new home at 5905 Wilshire Boulevard. According to the newspaper, 500,000 pieces... That can't be right. 50,000 pieces were moved, and they broke only one jar.
Oh, wow.
But it was worth $40 billion.
You shouldn't have given it to Laurel and Hardy to carry.
They just wanted to help out. They were so old, they wanted one last thing to do, and they broke Pandora's jar. And that's how we ended up with Abbott and Costello. So on March 31st, 1965, LACMA was officially open, and what sort of grand building was it housed in?
Yes, please tell me.
Why, the blandest of the blandest, of course. A lot of the story of LACMA is the architecture of LACMA. When it first opened, Arts and Architecture magazine said it suspended its policy of only reviewing buildings that were of exceptional merit to do a whole spread on how pitiful and inexcusable this museum looked. The problem with a public museum is that the board has so many different people on it with so many different viewpoints and tastes on it, and nobody on the board could agree on who should design the museum. So in the end, they compromised on somebody that nobody wanted, a local boy named William Pereira. Pereira.
Pereira.
Pereira.
Pereira.
Pereira. His company had also designed the LA Zoo and that Googie 76 station in Beverly Hills that we talked about.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
But for this, he wanted to go with something more grown up and serious to go along with the pompous sense that LA was finally mature enough to become a major cultural center. What we got was considered ugly and utilitarian. It was made up of three buildings. The Amundsen building, named for Howard Amundsen, who has been LACMA's biggest donor, having given around $100 million to them, which was the largest and would hold the permanent collection. Then there was the Bing Center, named for the husband of Anna Bing Arnold, Leo S. Bing, which had a 600-seat theater for programs and lectures, and the Litton Gallery, named after Bart Litton, for special exhibitions. All three of these buildings are still there, but in 1968, they did rename the Litton the Francis and Arm & Hammer Building.
Oh, you're right. You mean the supposed?
Alleged. The alleged... traitor to America. Somehow, Arm and Hammer is not related to Arm and Hammer. I checked.
I'm going to fight you on this.
I don't know how, and Army Hammer. I don't know how they're all not related, but we live in a crazy world, and I'm going to fix it.
It just doesn't make sense that their names are so close and they're not the same person.
It doesn't add up. It was renamed because Litton wanted that building to feature local artists, but the board wanted to be international, so he's out of the picture. The buildings, as you can go see them now, were not very decorative and didn't have many windows, but all three of them were originally suspended over a large reflecting pool. It didn't take long, though, for the reflecting pools to be paved over, because I guess they forgot that they were built on a sea of primordial goo and the tar kept seeping into them, so they had to get rid of it. Still, Time magazine called LACMA the temple on the tar pits, and when it opened, it was the largest new museum to be built in the United States behind the National Gallery of Art in Washington, D.C. For the collection itself, there wasn't much going on. The Alexander Calder sculpture, Hello Girls, was there from day one.
There's a sculpture for the first phrase I say when I wake up?
Well, you open up your window, Hello Girls. So it was there from day one, and after a narrow escape from the tar, it's still there today. Whoa. Other than that, though, almost half of their best stuff was on loan from Norton Simon's European art collection. So now that LACMA was born, it was time to start the decades-long process of actually getting it on its feet.
Yeah.
Their first director, we'll take it through via the directors. The first director was Richard F. Brown. Mm. He resigned on January 31st, 1966 because of his constant tension with the board due to the fact that he wanted to have the museum be more daring. The board disagreed. They wanted, milk for everybody.
We're all grows up now.
In March of 1966, in March of 1966, LACMA did do something daring by showing Edward Kienholz's backseat Dodge 38. I remember seeing it. It's weird that it was there for that long, but I remember seeing it a lot when I was a kid.
I'm not familiar with it.
It was a good representation of LA's car culture. It showed two teenagers making it in the backseat of a car. Like an actual car. An actual teenager. The teenagers, they were made out of like chicken wire or something like that.
Okay.
So it wasn't too graphic, but it got the job done. There was a huge outcry.
I've been kissing chicken wire this whole time.
That's right. I'm so turned on by chicken coops. There was a huge outcry over its pornographic nature, and the LA County Board of Supervisors tried to ban it and threatened to cut the funding of LACMA if they displayed
it. I thought they were going to cut the chicken wire.
Nothing can cut chicken wire except for a hungry fox's teeth. The compromise was that they would display it, but the door on the car would be kept closed and guarded and only opened if someone asked to look inside and there were no kids around.
That's even creepier.
Yeah.
Let me see the chicken wire kids.
Let me see. Just open the door. Give me the keys.
There's no kids around.
On June 8th, 1966, Kenneth Donahue was named director and began to pump up LACMA's focus on art education.
Oh, cool.
In 1967, they even opened an art conservation center. Donahue's time as director was marked with some landmark exhibitions. In May 1971, they had Art and Technology, which was a breakthrough for LACMA's reputation, which paired scientists and engineers with major artists like Andy Warhol, Roy Lichtenstein, and James Turrell. On September 30th, have you ever heard of them? You know who Andy Warhol is? You ever heard of his factory?
Yeah, he's had the hair.
He was that cute lady with the hair.
Yeah, it was Alan's brother, right?
On September 30th, 1976, two centuries of Black American art opened after their criticism for not paying attention to the Black community. Mm-hmm. 88,000 people came to see this and was one of the museum's first examples of trying to better reflect the diversity of the city, which they've always kind of been trying to do.
Yeah.
LACMA said its personal record when the Treasures of King Tutankhamun exhibit opened February 15th, 1978. It went on for 4 months and 1.25 million people came to see it. That record has yet to be broken for LACMA. In the 70s, they even started their famous film screening program that was almost canceled in 2009, but a lot of people were vocally upset about it, including Martin Scorsese, even though he did not give any money to back up his vocal upsetitude.
It's the only place they'll play Gangs of New York.
I'll give you $4 million if you only play my movies. Instead, they revamped it with a new partnership with Film Independent, still going strong.
Oh, cool.
Donahue's reign came to an end on February 8th, 1979, when he officially retired, and now get ready for the 80s.
Come take on, Eileen. Take on me, take on me, take
keep singing
me
that while I'm singing it. The 80s at LACMA was defined.
Oh,
Okay, go
ahead. The 80s at LACMA was defined by the man who became director on January 11th, 1980, and would stay director for the entire decade. So one guy steered us through that turbulent time full of cocaine. His name was Earl A. Powell III, or...
That's a very cocaine name.
Rusty, they'd call him.
Oh.
Rusty
Who's
Powell.
The director? Rusty.
Rusty.
Yeah, Rusty's
got it. Go talk to
it.
Rusty.
Talk to Rusty. Yeah, Rusty writes the checks.
He came from the National Gallery of Art in Washington, D.C., and wanted to make the museum not as stuffy and old-fashioned as it was. The St. Yo Grandma Saisons, although maybe some of them might have been, because in 1982 they were raided for possessing illegally obtained works.
This is my Grandma Saison.
But other than that, it's got her name in crayon on the back.
It's of her.
Other than that, it was a pretty good decade for LACMA. On June 28, 1984, they opened up a French Impressionist exhibit that pulled in 460,000, making it LACMA's fourth largest show ever. In 84, they also started their yearly Collectors Committee fundraiser, which is, it's kind of cool. It gathers a bunch of new potential artworks, and the rich citizens of the city come to pay to be a part of this gala, and then they all vote on their favorite one on display, and the one with the most votes gets added into the permanent collection.
Okay.
So they still do this.
That's
which
nice.
We've never been invited.
I mean, we'll wait for our invitation. I mean, mailbox every day is exhausting, but do you email it now or what?
No.
Still mail?
It's a form of mail that only rich people get. You wouldn't understand. The biggest change during this decade was the addition of an entirely new building. On December 13th, 1986, the Robert O. Anderson building opened. It's the big thing you see if you're looking at the museum on Wilshire.
Okay.
Yeah. It cost $35.3 million and became the new home of modern and contemporary art for the museum. You may know it as the Art of the Americas building, as it was renamed in 2007. You may also know it as Bland. In an attempt to spice things up on the LACMA campus, they yet again added their favorite spice to the mix, mayonnaise. It looks very 80s.
Yeah.
And it's very boring. What it did do was create a new main entrance to the museum. It made its home over the old entry bridge and the plaza that was the old main entrance. It also sealed the rest of the museum off from Wilshire, so it sort of isolated them, but it did create that nice plaza that they have there.
Yeah.
It was made by the Hardy Halsman Pfeiffer firm. It was described by a critic as like the foot in Monty Python. Like, it's just like everything's there and then... We'll put this on top. The plan was to remodel the original three buildings with the same facade as this one.
Yeah.
And they did that to part of the hammer, but the rest never happened.
Great. Okay. It's a work in progress.
No. They gave up. It's an officially admitted shame. This is where the disjointedness that LACMA is now known for started, but that wasn't it for disjointed new additions in the 80s. On July 28, 1988, the B. Gerald Cantor Sculpture Garden opened. It's an outdoor sculpture garden with eight Rodins in it, and it's free to the public, but it didn't end there. On September 25th, 1988, someone who's talking to you right now's birthday, the Pavilion for Japanese Art opened up. This was a brand new building to the east of the Amundsen, designed by Bruce Goff, and surprisingly, it was unanimously praised by everybody. It was the first building they made that were like, okay, that one's good.
Oh, finally you did it.
Yeah. They also finally added underground parking by the end of that decade.
Finally.
By the time Rusty Powell's time as director ended on April 28th, 1992, he had brought in $209.4 million in donations. He raised membership from 42,299 when he started to some 90,000 when he left. Annual attendance grew from 497,449 to 968,224. He got over 40,000 artworks promised or given to the museum's collection, and he started departments for photography, ancient and Islamic art, and Latin American art, all of which have grown into really impressive collections at this point.
Something good happened in the 80s?
This was the only good thing to happen in the 80s. Powell is credited with finally making LACMA a legitimate institution, but now we're in the 90s and things are starting to get weird. Red wine. Taking over for Rusty Powell on August 26, 1992 was Michael E. Shapiro. He had been chief curator of the St. Louis Art Museum, and he was ready to push LACMA forward despite the economic troubles the country was facing, with an emphasis on education and connecting to the community no matter how stressful it may be. August 20th, 1993, he resigned due to stress.
Oh, Shapiro stressed. That was the headline.
People were worried when he took the job that being a curator, because he had been a curator, they were worried that that didn't give him the expertise needed to perform the job of a director. Most of all, they thought he didn't have the fundraising experience that he needed. They were right. During his not even year-long stint, there was a lot of tension within the museum. Not a lot of donations were coming in. The budget got slashed. 23 staff members had to be laid off. There were shorter hours. hours, fewer programs. He couldn't connect to the community like he wanted, with millions fewer dollars than he thought he was going to have. Jeez. Some said it was Shapiro causing the tension within the museum and that he was really bad at making decisions. May or may not be true, but five curators resigned during the less than year that he was there. So it's a common
good sign.
This might have caused people to lose some of the confidence in LACMA that had been built up during the 80s, a theory that was backed up by the fact that the leadership at the museum was in question for the next 2 years. Like, they couldn't find anybody who, like, I don't want to get involved with that. LACMA was experiencing some serious financial setbacks and they had to regroup, and that was a lot of trouble for somebody new to inherit in the job. The rebuilding started in January 1994. LACMA got a 99-year contract with the Board of Supervisors to extend their public funding. That same month, LACMA bought the May Company building next door for $18.3 million. Mm-hmm. That's the one that's on the Fairfax-Wilshire intersection.
Right, okay.
It's a historic cultural monument, streamlined, modern building from 1939, sometimes referred to as the perfume bottle.
That's pretty cool.
It sprays scent into the air. It's wonderful. It's the last thing Notorious B.I.G. saw. And what a way to go out. That looks like a perfume bottle.
What?
They then spent another $3 million renovating that building, and eventually they reopened it on October 25th, 1998 as LACMA West for special programs and stuff like that, expanding the LACMA campus by 30%. It's a good start. They still needed a leader. Nobody wanted anything to do with this museum. In June 1995, though, they still had no taker for the job of director, but they needed somebody in charge, so they instead created a new co-head position in the museum of president and chief executive officer. This job went to Andrea L. Rich, who is the executive chancellor of UCLA.
They dragged her into it.
There's no financial problems here, are there?
No. We're pretending we don't know what financial means.
You can't have a financial problem if there's no finances. So, no. The top job was split in two so as to prevent another Shapiro situation, as it's now known throughout the biz, with a director who knows art but can't handle the business end of things. So Rich would now handle the business and fundraising and continue the search for a director who would handle the art-centric side of the operations, a plan many people were skeptical of, fearing it would create tension between the two bosses, like this sort of thing had done at other museums.
Yeah.
Again, they weren't wrong. They finally found a new director on March 28, 1996, in Graham W.J. Beale, and he did stay for a while and helped get some major things in motion. In January 1999, they opened their Van Gogh show that drew in 821,000 people, making it LACMA's third biggest show ever. He brought in a donation of 75 ancient Chinese pieces worth $3.5 million. Also in July 1999, Hancock Park behind the museum reopened after a decade of fundraising and renovations, making it an actually nice place to be, complete with the Dorothy Collins Brown Amphitheater for performances. But on September 9th, 1999, he left to run the Detroit Institute of Arts, and they just figured that's enough of the two-headed system. And Andrea Rich took over as director as well as being the president, and now there was just one boss to rule them.
Oh, that's the way that it all should be, right?
Yeah. And she consolidated power. She killed the heads of all the art departments just to make a point.
Just to see if she could, and she could.
Oh, Andrea. Seeing how Rich's background was in education and not art, people were still skeptical. This made LACMA the only major museum not being run by somebody who wasn't an art expert. This made a lot of people angry, but like her or not, she Y2K'd us into the new millennium, and she decided things needed to change drastically. She felt that the LACMA campus was getting too disjointed and an overhaul was needed to finally make it into one coherent structure. They held a design competition in 2001, and the winner of it was the Pritzker Prize winner, which is like the Pulitzer Prize for architecture. He was the winner of the year 2000, the Dutchman Rem Koolhaas.
He wins again.
His plan involved tearing down all three of the original buildings and also the Art of the Americas building and replacing it with one giant structure covered by this tent-like roof. The plan was approved, and all that was left to raise the money to make this, and then the recession hit. The big donors were less willing to give up the money needed for this project, whose cost rose from the original $200 million to $400 million, and plus all the money was needed up front and not in stages, which is typical of a Dutchman. He wanted all up front, and then he rides a windmill home. It also became clear that the entire museum would have to be shut down for 3 years during this construction. option. Yeah. So understandably, a tax increase for this plan was voted down as everybody was having money troubles at the time. But then one man stepped up who from here on in will be a very big part of this episode and pledged $50 million if other donors would step up and help cover the rest. This man was vice chairman of the LACMA board, Eli Broad, and nobody else stepped up to fund this new building. So by December 2002, the Cool Haas overhaul was dead. Some people just didn't want to see the old buildings go, and others felt silly giving so much money towards building a museum their name won't even be on when for the same amount of money they could have one named after them.
Yeah, which is, that's what it's all about.
Well, this must be where Broad then got the idea to take that $50 million he was going to give as part of this new mega building and instead give it to LACMA with the stipulation of using it to build a new regular building on the LACMA campus.
Right.
He gave the money wanting this new building to be dedicated to contemporary art, and he even got the very famous architect Renzo Piano to design it, my favorite Power Ranger.
And instrument.
This plan actually did move forward, and in 2003, Broad even sweetened the deal by promising that when the building was done, he would donate all of his post-war and contemporary art to this new LACMA building, which would be called the Broad Contemporary Art Museum. This would be a museum within the museum. So it would be on the western edge of the campus and would reorient the entire museum, now making the main entrance the new BP Grand Entrance and giving symmetry to the complex with LACMA West and the BCAM, as they call it, on the west, the BP Grand Entrance in the middle, and the older buildings on the east. So it's sort of like, we could duct tape this all together and it'll work. This became part of phase one of what they were calling the transformation to completely redo the LACMA campus.
Had to wait for a full moon.
Phase one included the BCAM, the BP Grand Entrance, and BB-8, a redoing of the atrium in the Amundsen, and a new underground parking lot, which opened in 2006.
It was even more underground.
You thought that other one was underground? That was above ground. During the construction of this new underground parking lot, they unearthed fossils of bison, camels, horses, saber-toothed cats, a baby mastodon, and an entire mammoth.
Oh my golly. Yeah.
And they were all double parked. A lot was happening, but money was still really tight.
But they found a bison. Just sell the bison.
Sell the bison. Those things go for thousands. In one controversial move, in fall 2005, they sold off 42 works of art valued at about $13 million to prepare for the BCAM expansion. These included Picasso's, Matisse's, Modigliani's. They were heavily criticized for this, but they defended it by saying that museums do this sort of thing all the time. They did it in 1982 to prepare for the construction of the Art of America's building. They sold hundreds of works then, but it only brought in $1.8 million. They estimate that nowadays the museum regularly sells some 200 items a year.
Oof.
They say they do it to get rid of redundant and unrepresentative items and to use that money to fill in the gaps in the collection, but others see it as unethical and superficial. Like, we just want the singles. We don't want any of the albums. Nah. Give me my Sharona, but I don't want to hear the rest.
Knack's a good band. Give them a chance.
No. Despite all this, Andrea Rich managed to raise membership to 118,000. She brought a King Tut exhibit back to LACMA in 2005, which I went to, and I think I saw Leonardo DiCaprio in the gift shop.
Really?
Yeah.
Did he talk about Gangs of New York?
Yeah, he said, have you gone to the Bing Theater? This King Tut show wasn't as big as the first one.
It wasn't as big as the first one.
No, it never is. It didn't even have Steve Martin singing at the end. It was only the second biggest LACMA show of all time, bringing in 937,613 people over 137 days. They even started to build up a large Mexican art collection under Andrea Rich's direction. She solved most of LACMA's financial problems and set them on the path that they're now on towards maybe great things. Then all of a sudden, on November 7, 2005, with so much going on,
the second recession hit.
The self-inflicted LACMA recession. The localized Wilshire and Fairfax recession hit. She resigned November 7, 2005. She said she resigned because of power struggles with the board, but she probably misspoke and meant to say the Broad. People had criticized her for giving Broad too much power and how the museum was being run, but he was giving them so much money and art and stuff, so what's the big deal? Well, let's see now.
Yeah, break it down for
me. Let's take the mask off your precious hero. With Rich gone, they needed a new director, but they got turned down by people from all over the world.
There
were reputations. Yeah. But finally, on February 2nd, 2006, after 12 years of running the Dia Art Foundation, Michael Govan was appointed as the seventh director to run LACMA. He's still there right now. Govan is a contemporary art kind of guy, so he brought a lot of focus on that into the museum. He also wanted more outdoor art that people could interact with, like Tulips by Jeff Koons and Fire Truck by Charles Ray, which both had to be removed because they were interacted with too much, and that and the elements being outside, which is where elements thrive, it was starting to ruin them.
They also had the other element of tar.
Yeah.
The hidden element.
Those tar tidal waves that every few years happen. The first major outdoor art piece he brought in was Urban Light by Chris Burden that opened up February 7th, 2008. It's a nod, again, to LA's car culture. It's the street lamps thing.
Yeah,
it's made up of 202 actual street lamps from the 20s and 30s from different neighborhoods around LA that the artist, he started collecting in 2000 with a couple that he found at the Rose Bowl flea market.
Oh, cool.
The same artist also had a performance piece in the 70s where he got shot in the arm for art.
Like, really shot in the arm.
Shot in the arm with a gun.
With a bullet.
Was it like part of an alibi, like to get out of the feds office case or something?
He just saw Star Wars and he was like, I want to lose an arm. He wanted to make this thing that was the centerpiece of that romantic comedy with Ashton Kutcher and the lady from That 70s Show. He wanted it because there was no grand staircase or any sort of defining building of LACMA, like a museum like the Guggenheim or something like that has. So he was hoping this would become the symbol of LACMA, and it kind of did. Not even a couple weeks after that, on February 16th, the BCAM officially opened.
Yay.
But the celebration was a little bit dampened by a couple events that had happened the month before. First, dozens of federal agents swooped in on four museums in Southern California, LACMA included, for having bought illegally obtained Native American and Asian art.
Whoa.
This was the culmination of a five-year undercover sting operation, which brought to light that not just outside of this and the other event, like we talked about, happened a few decades earlier, LACMA had actively pursued pieces they knew to have been looted in the past.
Like movies, like art heist movies.
Yeah, only they're the bad guys. But this got mostly swept under the rug. The real damper on the party was that same month, just a month before the museum named after him was set to be open, Eli Broad decided to go back on his promise and rescinded his offer to donate all of his contemporary art to LACMA.
Great.
Nice guy.
Yeah.
He instead elected to loan it out to several museums rather than just give it all to just one. His reasoning was that LACMA wouldn't commit to permanently displaying his works, and rather than have them stay in storage, he'd rather other museums got the chance to also display them.
Mm-hmm.
Others saw this as a last-minute lack of confidence in the museum and some sort of silly ploy to have a museum all of his own where he would have full control, which he denied and then later did. Supporters of LACMA worried that it would send a message to all future potential donors that if somebody like Broad wouldn't give his art to them, why should anybody else, especially not giving it to be housed in a building named after him? Either way, it seriously undermined what LACMA was trying to do in becoming a major cultural institution.
Mm-hmm.
This wasn't the first time in history, though, that donors had pulled away from LACMA. In the late 30s, Walter and Louise Arensberg were going to give them a ton of Latin American art, but the museum just didn't seem interested, so they instead gave it to the Philadelphia Museum of Art. Like we said, and Greg will probably say again, Norton Simon pulled out all of his work after a power struggle with the other trustees in 1975. Mm-hmm. Also in the 70s, Catherine White offered to give a huge collection of African art, but LACMA wasn't interested yet again. I don't want art that isn't white. So she gave that to the Seattle Art Museum. And meanwhile, like all these museums are like, they went on like, this is a world-class museum.
Yeah.
Arm & Hammer was going to give another large collection, but LACMA didn't want to give in to his demands either.
Oh boy.
Which, to be fair,
what's the phrase about beggars? They can't be something.
They can't be giving in to weak donors.
That's what it is. That's the beautiful phrase everyone remembers.
But to be fair about the Arm & Hammer thing, one of his demands was that all the stuff he had donated in the past had to be given back to him, and he wanted all the names of the other donors taken off of the rooms that his art would be displayed in.
Oh, that's insane. Okay.
Yeah.
Well,
we could cut him loose.
Yeah, yeah.
So he branched off and he formed his Hammer Museum in Westwood in 1989.
Yeah.
He'll get his own episode.
Yeah.
Walter Annenberg was also going to give all of his stuff to LACMA, but ended up going with the Met in New York instead. World-class museum. Museums grow with donations, but the drama that comes with it is a donation you cannot deny. Regardless, the BCAM opened, and boy, was it underwhelming yet again. It was another bland building added to the bland LACMA campus made by an architect known for being incredibly daring.
Oh.
In addition to the addition, Broad had said he would pay for every penny of this new addition, but LACMA maintains that it cost $55.5 million million and he only gave 50 million. So they're 5.5 million in the hole. Broad interfered yet again when in 2008 as well, there were talks to merge LACMA with the Ailing Museum of Contemporary Art, but Broad saved them with a donation and that deal was off, but the transformation kept moving forward, forward, onward. And that included opening up yet another contemporary art building next to the BCAM. Mm-hmm. This was put in motion just a month after the BCAM opened. It was completed October 2nd, 2010 as the $45 million Linda and Stuart Resnick Exhibition Pavilion. It's the biggest open plan museum in the world and was also designed by Renzo Piano and was yet another plain addition to the LACMA. They're just like warehouses. I don't know.
Yeah.
Maybe there's the fumes from the tar like inhibit you.
No, this looks great. Yeah. Four walls and no roof. That's exactly what we wanted.
So this building was part of phase two of the transformation, which also included another outdoor piece, Levitated Mass, which is the giant boulder by Michael Heiser, which opened June 24th, 2012, after the 340-ton rock was transported for 11 nights to LACMA on a 200-wheeled truck traveling at 7 miles per hour from a quarry in Riverside.
Wow.
The 10 million...
That was the most boring parade I ever went to.
I was blowing my noisemakers. The rock didn't even wave at me. Dwayne Johnson did. The $10 million piece and demonstration of moving it here was meant to show a modern version of like societies moving huge pieces of earth for their art and for their construction. But now that it's just there, it's just there.
Also, keep moving it.
Move it again, but just a little bit. Also as part of phase two was supposed to be a giant hanging train by Jeff Koons that was...
A drain?
Train. Citizen train. A giant train that was supposed to like dangle.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Like the Jurassic Park ride.
Oh, right. Yeah. That's funny. That's funny.
But that never panned out.
Train never came to station.
No, it got held up in Riverside. Govan has been credited with doing for LACMA what Dudamel did for the Philharmonic and pushing it to the next level and getting new and exciting things going. In December 2007, he got the museum a gift from Janice and Henry Lazaroff to really fill out the museum's modernist collection with 130 pieces by people like Picasso, Klee, Kandinsky. That same year, they got a huge loan of Latin American pre-Columbian art. Mm-hmm. In 2008, they got a large collection of Oceania art and 3,500 photographs. In January 2009, they got a huge acquisition of 18th and 19th century European clothing with around 250 outfits and 300 accessories, giving LACMA one of the best collections of this sort of thing in the world and maybe probably the best in the country. Yeah. That's especially good because now costume designers from the studios nearby have everything they need to consult for taking place between the year 1700 and 1915. Just go see.
Yeah.
We have all the clothes that was made from that time. They teamed up with the Getty to acquire over $30 million worth of the works of the photographer Robert Mapplethorpe.
Mm-hmm.
It's currently seen as old-fashioned to rely heavily on European art in a museum. So they've begun to collect more art from Africa and Asia and adding to their already large Latin American collection. They now have one of the best collection of Islamic art in the world. They want to better reflect the population of the city. So in 2009, they had a show focusing entirely on current Korean artists.
Mm-hmm.
The museum says that they now have the most comprehensive holding of traditional Korean art outside of Korea, and we're not giving it up. In 2010, they wanted to make the campus more attractive, so Robert Irwin, the same guy who did the gardens at the Getty, which are very attractive, he started his primal palm garden of putting these huge palm trees that you see around the two Renzo Piano buildings.
Yeah, yeah.
That same year, they reached out of their boundaries and helped in preserving the Watts Towers.
Mm-hmm.
They opened up better restaurants within the museum with Rays and the Stark Bar and the Coffee Plus Milk Cafe. They brought back the old Arts and Technology Lab and are pairing artists with companies like Google and NVIDIA and SpaceX. They've been making better use of the local film community by getting people like Barbara Streisand and Ryan Seacrest and Brian Grazer onto the board of trustees.
Ryan Seacrest is on the board?
Yeah.
Good for him.
Ryan Seacrest is everywhere.
Seacrest.
He hosts the board. They put on the Tim Burton exhibition in 2011, the Stanley Kubrick one in 2012, went to it twice, stole so many things.
Two little outfits for us to wear from The Shining.
And one axe to get our business done. In October 2011, they even leased out the May Company building to the Academy of Motion Pictures Arts and Sciences to build a new $300 million museum to film, which will open in 2018.
Neat. Can't wait.
Yeah, I'm excited for that.
Yeah.
I went to a pre-exhibition they had in there of film costumes.
Oh, really? What was the winning piece? What did you walk away thinking I should
own that? Darth Vader's suit.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. And I walked away in it.
It is big.
No one's stopping Darth Vader from walking out of the museum. Surprisingly, I know how to use the Force. And I choked so many docents.
I didn't really get the distance thing down, so I just held my hand to their neck. But, you know, it works. It's the Force.
I use the Force of, you know, my biceps. In 2014, the new Subway to the Sea Purple Line broke ground on the plot of land that LACMA had bought in 2008 next to the Peterson Museum, which is expected to be completed in 2019 and will make getting to LACMA via public transportation actually possible.
That would be great.
Under Govan, LACMA has expanded to cover 7 buildings across 20 acres of land, but there is still one problem that has been there from the start. The buildings are just too disjointed.
Yeah.
It's not cohesive at all. Honestly, the two Renzo Piano buildings, I've been to them once and that was like a year ago because I thought it was a separate, like I didn't know it was part of LACMA. Like
Is this a subway?
I didn't know I was allowed in there. It really, like, it doesn't make sense.
Yeah.
So this is where phase 3 of the transformation comes in. The Zumthor plan.
Oh.
Episode 3. The older buildings are run down and leaky and it would cost to bring them up to code.
I thought this was part of their thing. Part
of the charm.
Yeah.
To bring all these up to code, it would cost over $350 million.
Oh,
as an alternative, Govan enlisted the 2009 Pritzker Award winning Swiss architect, don't go with the Dutch anymore, Peter Zumthor, to do a complete redesign of the LACMA campus. So in his new design, the three original buildings and the Art of America buildings will be demolished. All that will remain is the Japanese Pavilion and the two Renzo Piano buildings, and in the place of the old buildings will be one giant dark blob-like megastructure.
Cool.
Yeah. This will be Zumthor's first work in the United States and is meant to emphasize more of a connection with the building to the city and satisfying the city's need for more public spaces. It was also designed in that blob-like way in homage to the tar that has been plaguing the museum forever. It will be raised 30 feet in the air on giant glass cylinders. It will have no main entrance, but rather several different entrances. The roof will be covered in solar panels that will power the entire building and will save about $5 million a year in operating costs. The layout will also allow for more of the collection to be on display than ever before. Right. In June 2014, the design had to be redone out of respect for the Page Museum, who said that the new design would be blocking light and rainfall from the tar pits and disrupting the ecosystem. So the current design is now less blob-like and more angular, which I'm not as big of a fan of.
Yeah, I wanted the blob.
But the blob, it creeps and leaps and flies, and that's actually
beware.
The tar.
Beware.
Beware of the tar. Line. We lost the blob, but now it's going to cross over Wilshire. Like, it's going to be suspended over Wilshire into a parking lot that LACMA owned at the corner of Wilshire and Spalding. And that actually sounds kind of cool. Like, you're going to walk over Wilshire to see your precious Monets.
I like that idea a lot.
Monet, 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 Monet. The coloring of it also got changed from all black to some lighter elements. And I'm sure the design is going to change even more by the time they're expected to break ground in 2018. Yeah. It might be fully black again, like you've always wanted.
I want another structure that looks like the tar has taken over.
Oh no, the tar one.
Oh, the tar blob woke up. They dug too deep.
They should make it shaped like a giant mastodon. Is this what you wanted, Page Museum? Fine. The new building is expected to be done in 2023, and in the meantime, the collection will be displayed in the BCAM and the Resnick buildings. This is all going to cost around $650 million, and something because of the obstacles and the ambitions involved, it might mimic what the Getty went through to be created, and will end up costing closer to $1 billion.
It's funny reading all this art collecting that you like, $3 million is not that much. Like, it's a lot of money.
Yeah. And as it goes on, it's like, well, she gave $50,000. Oh, wow. He gave $3 million. Oh, wow. He gave $100 million. Yeah. Oh, he's giving $1 billion.
Yeah. But it means nothing.
Yeah. The thing with this, though, Govan was smart and came to the donors with the design first rather than asking them for money first, because now they don't get an input and there's not some sort of weird compromise of the building being built again.
Yeah.
The day after the plans were approved, the former agent of Marlon Brando and Elizabeth Taylor, who was also the owner of Lowe's Theater, and the ex-CEO of Univision, A. Gerald Perenchio, he promised to donate 47 paintings by people like Monet, Picasso, and Degas worth $500 million after he dies if this new building is actually completed.
Wow.
So this would be the biggest gift that LACMA has ever gotten. With all of the failed plans for redesign in the 21st century, people were skeptical, but it looks like this new building is actually going to happen. And if it is, it's expected to be the biggest piece of architecture for the city since the Disney Concert Hall. LA was the only city in the world with the chance to completely redo one of its main museums, and we're actually doing it, which is kind of exciting. Yeah, yeah. And not just that, by going with Zumthor, we are making a statement by going with something new and exciting and kind of untested, rather than just another Renzo piano design that so many cities have gone with and is kind of played out by this point. It's exciting that something that this big is going to happen during our lifetime, but at the same time, there's a concern that this is yet another example of LA obliterating its past and demolishing all of its old buildings, which we have a history of doing, for just new ones, rather than adhering to the idea that a city is shaped by its accumulated memory. So the question is, will future generations resent us for demolishing buildings that may look boring and ugly to us, but will be beautiful to them, like how Art Deco and Googie buildings now for the generation before us? So that's where LACMA is. They celebrated their 50th birthday last year. It opened up in a time when the city didn't have a Getty Museum or a Hammer or a Norton Simon or a MoCA, and it set out to match the Met in New York, even though they had a 100-year head start on them. They're making pretty good progress. They're on Snapchat.
Woo!
And, ooh, it's sexy.
Yeah.
With over 120,000 items, it is the largest art museum west of the Mississippi, and as disjointed and mishmashed as it's been, that's just how LA is, baby. It's just a lot of weird things that are smashed together, and this is us. It's collaborative, it's rich men going crazy, and if you don't like that, you can see LACMA being destroyed in the movies Volcano and Miracle Mile, and in Ed Ruscha's painting Los Angeles County Museum on Fire.
Oh, that's right.